So I'm sure you can tell by the title that this is not a tutorial, this is not a vlog, it's not anything like that. This is more like a serious type video. So stay tuned. Alright, so it is the 29th of January when I'm filming this, and tomorrow is Bella Let's Talk. So for those of you who don't know what Bella Let's Talk is, it is an annual event that is started with Bell Canada, the service provider, and they raise money every year on this day for mental health societies and people and all those like different types of charities and stuff like that. And the goal of Bell Let's Talk is to end the stigma against mental health and bring mental health awareness to other people and know how to use proper and safe language, which is something super important that not a lot of people talk about. So a very popular thing that is with Bell Let's Talk is when this day comes around, since it's a day to end stigma, you share your story. And you share your story with mental illnesses and mental health and people you've had to deal with, your friends and family, because not a lot of people realize that mental illness doesn't have a face. It can be anyone, it can affect anyone. It doesn't matter how old you are, it doesn't matter what race you are, it doesn't matter. Nothing matters about that at all. And you would think that a lot of people that you know today who are super outgoing, super high functioning, are completely okay. But these are the people that are suffering in silence. And we're suffering in silence because it's gotten better, of course, but there has been a time where society was not a safe place for people who were dealing with mental illnesses. Because of the terrible like consumptions everyone has, and not consumptions, assumptions people have, and how we can be so harsh and how we throw our words around like crazy, psycho, all that, we don't really think about who it's affecting and how it's affecting someone, you know? So I decided I was gonna do a video talking about my mental health and my struggles and how I coped, and basically hoping that whoever's watching this can find some strength in me and borrow some, because honestly we're here for everyone. I'm here for anyone, so I think this is really important for me to be transparent as someone who's very present online, and obviously I talk about everything, so like I think this is something that needs to be talked about. I'm just gonna say this right now before I get into everything. This is my trigger warning for people that are watching this now that might not be able to handle some of the topics that I'm going to be talking about, because obviously mental health isn't always pretty, and I realize that some things that I may say could affect others and trigger them into a bad place, and I obviously don't want to do that, so I'm just telling you right now that this is it. If you can't handle stuff like that, then just click out of the video. I won't be upset. Okay, so here we go. So if you know me, you know I'm a very outgoing person. I'm super extroverted, bubbly, laugh a lot, like that's just my personality. So you probably wouldn't think that I've struggled with the things that I'm about to tell you. A lot of people, like I said, mental illness does not have a face. It does not discriminate. So I think it's important that I talk about this, because it takes a lot for me to be able to sit here and be able to do this and be able to talk, because like I still hurt sometimes. And it's not something that you just kind of get over or like you're cured of. So yeah, here we go. My first real, I guess, experience with mental health or mental illness probably started before I knew, but I really, really was affected once I was in about grade 6, like 12, 11 years old. So I did not have a good, like, not childhood, but like school, like it was not good for me. I was bullied. I wasn't an outcast, because sometimes I did have friends, but my friends weren't how friends were supposed to act or how they were supposed to treat you. And I kind of experienced that from the moment I hit grade 1. Like, it was so crazy to me because I'm 6, like, I haven't done anything to anyone really. But I knew from that time that I was not liked and I was not able to click with the other girls that I went to school with. And it's so weird for me to think about that because I was so young and it's like, why? Like, what was wrong with me? And I wondered that for a long time, like, what is wrong with me? Why don't people like me? And it was a struggle for me. So I guess when I got into grade 6, a lot of the drama and stuff that I was experiencing with school was taking a big toll on me. I didn't know what to call it or how to express it, because obviously I'm young, like, I didn't know that I was suffering from depression. I didn't know that I was suffering from anxiety. I didn't know a lot of the things that were wrong with me. I just knew that I sometimes felt like I was gonna throw up to go to school, that I physically could not go to school. I came home bawling, crying. I would burst into tears for absolutely no reason. I was sleeping a lot. I wasn't happy, but I didn't know how to say that. I thought, this is what happens. This is just part of growing up. So I'm around 13 now. Things haven't necessarily gotten better at all. So by this time I'm like completely like online. Like, I knew I had a phone and like an iPod back then, and I was online. This is when I kind of started immersing myself in like the internet and like making internet friends, because those are like the only people that I felt like weren't judging me, were there for me. I was really, really present on Tumblr at the time, and Tumblr, I guess, could put a face to what I was feeling, or like words to what I was feeling, how depressed I was feeling. And I didn't realize that I was severely depressed until I kind of did that research and I saw, oh wow, other people are feeling like this. This is what this is. And I'm not gonna say like it was a good thing for me to be on there or it was a bad thing. Like, I guess it was good because I was able to find a way to express myself, because I was like, this is what's wrong. But it was a bad thing because it wasn't like the people on there were necessarily uplifting or positive. So it was hard for me because that was the year I started self-harming. So yeah, that's the trigger warning for this. So I'm gonna go into that. So if you don't wanna hear about that, please exit this video. Yeah, I started self-harming at that age. I think I was 12, about to be 13. And my depression had gotten so bad that I thought I wanted to kill myself. And I found out that some people do this as a way to release the endorphins that we so desperately need. So that's when I started doing it. It was like a control thing for me because I felt like I couldn't control anything else going on in my life, so this was the best way to do it. And it's not, trust me. I was doing this for a bit. At this time, my relationship with my parents had kind of declined, especially my mom, because I remember there was times where like I would just explode. Like, I couldn't handle it. Like, I was so sad and depressed and angry because I didn't understand why this was what's happening to me, that I would take it out on her and she wouldn't understand again because she doesn't know what's going on. I never told her. So she not understanding would, like, it would just be back and forth, like, of us blowing up on each other because we don't know how to express to the other what's going on. And I experienced that a lot. I think grade 7 or 8 now, she found out what had been going on. She found out I had been getting bullied. And it was then when I really, she found out about my self-harming and all this. It was then when I was able to really explain to her how I was depressed. Like, Mom, I'm depressed. And it was hard for her to hear that or to accept that because she couldn't understand, like, her little daughter wants to die. Like, no parent wants to hear that, or no parent wants to ever go through that and have to hear that. It was hard for her to understand what I meant. And if you know, if you're from a Black family, or if you're from a family and you're a person of color, you know that the stigma that our communities have against mental illness, like, it's bad. So telling that to my immigrant mother is something that it's hard because they don't want to hear that. That doesn't happen, right? But it does happen, and it happened to me, and it happened to my friends. And it's just important that we break that, you know, because who is it helping? It doesn't help anyone, obviously. So she found out what had happened. She found out about my self-harming. I believe I never went to a doctor personally about my depression or anxiety, because the thing she did not want me to do was be on medication, because she had heard so many stories about people on medication, it makes them worse, all that stuff. And so I kind of just had to deal with it, you know. I believe I was doing some counseling and therapy, just kind of trying to deal with it. And then I got into high school. I was excited for high school because I thought, okay, wow, like, high school, I'm going to start over completely. I'm gonna make new friends. Like, this is gonna be different for me. It's not gonna be like elementary school at all. Like, I'm gonna have a much better experience. So I thought. Okay. I got into high school. I wasn't self-harming as much. I wouldn't say I had stopped, because there was a few times I definitely relapsed. And there was times where I definitely was like, I'm going to kill myself. So I wouldn't say I stopped. But yeah, so I started school and I was happy because new people, and it started off good for me because I made friends with a bunch of new girls and I felt like maybe I'm fitting in. But there is this one boy, and it felt like he had decided that it was his mission to make my time in high school hell. Not sure why. I've never done anything to this guy. But he would make up rumors about me, call me mean names, be super vulgar towards me, and have other people try to make other people, like, do the same thing. And not very, okay. My dog just knocked on my lap. Say hi. Okay, go. So not very long, like, my good start started to go down because people, especially guys in my school, they were very cliquey. My school was very cliquey. Well, my high school was very cliquey, and they all would talk and make the little jokes because they thought it was funny. They thought it wasn't affecting me, and I realized, like, okay, so high school's about to be just like elementary school. I'm not gonna say I didn't have friends, because I did, but it's hard when you have friends but none of your friends get picked on. It's only you. Like, it's, and you don't know why it's you. You just happen to be the person that everyone wants to attack or say mean things about. And I kind of like try to get over it, push it away and stuff. But it was just getting worse. In 11th grade or 10th, going to like 11th grade, I started to, like, I don't know, like it was just worse for me. Everything felt, I felt up and down. I felt anxious about everything. I didn't want to do things to upset other people because I was so scared about what would happen, like how they would treat me, and all I wanted to be was liked. So like, it was hard for me to act normal in a function, like in a setting, like a social setting. I feel like I wasn't doing well in school. I felt out of place. I was sleeping all the time. I didn't do my homework. Like, my life just kind of collapsed in on me. And I was just trying to swim in a pool that was too deep. Kind of, that's how it felt. And I was just so tired that I just stopped swimming. And I started, seeing a counselor at my school, because, like a social worker, because I was so severely depressed. I started doing school like at home. Like, I would have some of my classes, and I'd get workbooks and stuff, and I'd take them home and I'd do them, and then I'd come to school in the evening, because I was a French immersion student, or not the evening, but like the last period of the day, and I would take that French class and then I would go home. So that's what started to happen, and I was like required to talk to a social worker like once a week just to see how I was and everything. I started experiencing things like hallucinations, voices, things like that. And I didn't really voice that to anyone, not even the social worker. But I realized that something much deeper was wrong. I had struggled with mood and my up and downness since I was like 12, but I didn't realize what it was. And I started doing my own research, because who was there to talk to, you know? It's kind of hard to open up about this type of stuff. So I'm opening up to you guys, but yeah, it was really hard for me to like put a name to it. And then bipolar disorder. I had come across the research, and I started figuring out that all these symptoms and all these things, like I had experienced it from the mania to the down times. And I realized that this is something that I could possibly have. I had been doing things that I didn't realize were not normal or out of character, and I didn't realize that a symptom of bipolar is psychosis. So the voices and the hallucinating that I was hearing and seeing stuff was a part of that. I didn't know that. So the summer before grade 12, like the ending of months, I was in a really, really bad place. And I told my social worker that I didn't feel safe, that I think I was going to commit suicide. And she right away said, "Okay, you know what I have to do." And honestly, the best thing I could have done was tell her that, because I knew that if I had not, I probably would have ended my life, and I wouldn't be here being able to tell you guys about this. And, you know, it is very hard. I know someone, like if you know someone, or you are that person and you struggle with your thoughts like that, and someone is like, "Okay, you know what I have to do? I have to get you safe." Like, it feels like it's a threat, but it's like literally the best thing someone can do for you. you know, like, they just want you to be safe, and sometimes it can make you angry because you're like, why did I tell them? Like, this is like not fair, like they're gonna lock me away, they're gonna, you know, but honestly, they literally just want to keep you safe. And so she called my parents. My parents came and picked me up. They took me to St. Leonard's, and St. Leonard's is like a mental health, like, kind of a place where you go. It's like they have like a kid's health phone, like, same type thing, you know? And I went there and I talked to someone, and yeah, I was then put, like, they were watching kind of over me, and I went home with my parents. So that summer, I kind of was doing a lot of reflecting on my life, and I told my mom, I said, Mom, I think I have bipolar. And she was like, bipolar? She's like, what do we do, kind of thing. Like, it's heartbreaking because it's like depression, anxiety, bipolar. Like, let's just add it all in one bunch, like, you know. So I was diagnosed in 2016, just before grade 12. Yeah, just before grade 12. But I did not go on any medication. Yeah. I started seeing a psychologist who had diagnosed me, and I saw my family doctor who had referred me to see a psychologist so I could get diagnosed. And that's when I started doing that. Or was it 2016? I don't know. I think it was 2016, but yeah, that happened. So I wasn't going on medication. But fast forward a year, I'm now going into college. My bipolar has essentially gotten worse. I am angry, I am depressed, I am exploding on other people. I don't know how to handle myself most of the time. If I'm manic, I'm doing whatever I want. I find that when I'm manic, if you don't know, like, mania is like an extreme high that people with bipolar disorder experience. It can make us just do things that are out of the ordinary, like spend obscene amounts of money, do risky things that we normally wouldn't be doing. But at the time, if you're bipolar, you know that that's the only time you're gonna really be super productive. I was not sleeping when I was manic. I don't need to sleep, or like that's how I felt. Like there was no point. It was just like I was living on a high, and then I would crash, and every single time I crash, it's a bad crash. It's like being sober or like trying to be sober, but you're a drug addict, and then you're on this really great high, and then once you're sober, it's like you gotta wake up, like this is a nightmare, you know? And that's how it was for me. And I felt like, what is there honestly to live for? Everything is just terrible. I'm not good at school. I felt like there was no reason. I had failed like classes, and I was just like, what? Like, what is there for me at this point? So before, I'm about to go into college now, and I'm like petrified because like I know how I did in high school. And I start medication. They put me on lithium. So lithium is like the drug of choice for bipolar people. In that year of my first year of college, I was on 4 different medications. So I went from lithium, Zoloft, Effexor, and one other. Oh, and Risperidone. And Effexor is a antidepressant. Zoloft was also an antidepressant. I stopped Zoloft and switched it out for Effexor because Zoloft was not helping or making me feel any better. And Risperidone is an antipsychotic. I was taking that for my hallucinations and the voices in my head. And the thing is, I only experienced that when I was severely repressed. That's when I would get really mad. So that's what I was taking throughout that year, or like months in that year, like when I was switching out. So the terrible thing about all this is the medication made me gain weight, a lot of weight. And that's when I've always been skinny, but grade 7, 6, 8 kind of, I had weird views on my body even though I was skinny, and I didn't know like what that was. Like, I would feel like it still wasn't. I guess because I was feeding myself with such negative comments that everyone was giving me, and then I would just feed it back to myself. I didn't like anything about myself. My body dysmorphia is something that I don't really talk to a lot of people because they don't understand, because they're like, you're so thin. What are you talking about? Like, you're tiny. But in my head, they don't understand. Like, what I see is something completely different at the time. So fast forward to my first year in college, and it's coming to the close like of the year, and I'm gaining all this weight, and I'm like, oh my goodness, like, what? Like, it made me feel gross. It made me worse. Like, they are prescribing these medications to make me feel better, but it's like, I'm feeling worse. Like, how does it work? Because I'm hating myself because I'm gaining all this weight, you know? Like, it's making me more depressed. So that summer was crazy, because the summer that like kind of just passed, because I was going to the gym, I was trying to do anything I could to like lose my weight because I felt really bad about it. I have finally, like, it was just not a good time. In June, I had another kind of relapse. I am so lucky to have like the parents that I do, and the friends that I do, and the boyfriend that I do, because I thought that like everything was over. Like, it just wasn't, like, nothing was worth living anymore. And they were so supportive. They just wanted to do anything that would make me feel okay. And I'm so lucky for that, because not a lot of people have that. And it took my mom a while to really understand, but she's like my number one. Like, I can go to her for anything. Like, whenever I feel crazy, like, I literally can go to her. Like, she has my back. And I would hope a lot of people deserve that. So during that time, like, that month of June was just like very sensitive to me, because I was like testing. It was like I was testing myself to see, like, okay, I'm gonna give myself this much amount of time, or this much amount of time, to like prove to myself that there is something that worth is living for, you know? I'm gonna let this ride out for this month and see, you know? And that's what I did, and I did that for the whole summer. I just kept saying, I'm gonna give myself more time. I'm gonna see. And then, come around now, I've decided I want to be off my medication. My medication was making me fat, it was making me depressed, I just couldn't handle it, it was numbing me out. And I remember my psychiatrist said to me, my mom was in the room, he said, there's no cure for bipolar, you're not going to get better, so this is why you need to keep taking this medication. And I remember thinking I could have burst into tears right then and there. That was the most discouraging thing I ever heard, ever. Ever. Because I was like, I'm not gonna get better at all. So, like, what is the point living a life where I'm just gonna be like this, right? And it was like a terrible thing to say, especially if you're like a health practitioner. Like, what? Why would you say that? He switched out. I just remembered the last medication, because it just came up in my head. He switched out my lithium for Topamax. Topamax is another drug that they're using for bipolar. It's not as popular as lithium, but they also use it for like seizures and people who want to lose weight and stuff. So he was like, this won't let you gain any weight, so this will be good. And I said, okay. I started taking it. After about a month, I was withdrawn off of lithium, and I had stopped. Oh, I had withdrawn from Effexor as well. And Effexor was terrible to withdraw from because it was shakes, nausea. Like, I ended up in the hospital. I had to leave work. I didn't go to work because I felt so terrible because I had stopped taking my medication, and it was only for one day that I had stopped taking the medication from. And it was terrible. Like, I would have tremors. Like, it was just awful. So by this time, I'm off Effexor, I'm off Zoloft, and I'm off lithium now. And I'm about to be off lithium and be on Topamax. So I was only on one medication, and I was really happy because I was like, one medication like this, I can work with this. Like, I just feel better not being on so many of them. So I finally was able to just be taking that, and I remember 4 weeks after I'm taking the medication, I got sick. I got like bronchitis or something, and I was like, I just didn't take the medication. I just stopped. And I'm not saying to do, listen, I'm not saying for anyone who is currently on medication for mental health or anything to stop taking your medication without speaking to a doctor. Do not do that. Just because I did it and I didn't have any negative effects and I didn't freak out or do anything does not mean that everyone should follow what I did. What I did was risky and it was not necessarily safe, okay? I just stopped taking my medication, and I don't know, I just stopped. And by this time, I had changed a few things in my life. I had been going to the gym regularly with my mom, and if you don't know, like, the gym is really good, especially if you're struggling with mental illness, because it can make you feel so much better. I'm not saying it's secure, but it definitely is like something that will make you, like, just a little something, like, you know how like Tylenol like takes away pain, even if the pain comes back, you just take another one, that kind of thing. Like, the gym is like the healthier version of that, you know? So I was going to the gym regularly. I'd recently incorporated this new diet that I think I'm gonna make a YouTube video about soon. So I'm not gonna like talk that much about it. And I could see that things were different. I was felt different. I was calmer. I felt less in my head. I hadn't been hearing voices or hallucinations for a while. I'm not gonna say that I was cured or whatever, like, because obviously, trust me, I have days where I am ready to just, like, it's terrible. Like, and I think that someone with depression, anxiety, bipolar, schizophrenia, anything, you know that this is kind of your life. It's something that you have to live with, but it's not something that you have to make put you down or destroy you. You know, like, this is something that you can fight, and that's what I've learned to do. Like, is to just fight it. Therapy is such a big thing. Having supportive friends is such a big thing. Friends and family. Being able to know you have people to reach out to when you feel like it's your last is such an important thing to do. I felt like there were times where I felt like I had no one whatsoever, but that wasn't obviously true. Like, I just needed to open up to people, and they were there, ready to listen. I now, whenever I feel totally distressed, I just play my music, I get in the bath, I just relax, and I get out of my head. I think finding distractions and coping mechanisms that are safe and healthy is so important. You just have to find what works for you. It's easier said than done, because sometimes you may do these things and you still feel like crappy after, but it's like, even if you just push and you keep doing it, it's better than doing the unhealthy thing, like self-harming, which I've experienced both sides. I've experienced the unhealthy coping mechanisms, and I've experienced the healthy coping mechanisms. And I'm telling you, this side is much better, you know? Eating differently even makes a change. Just changing the way things, like, the things that you put in your body, because we don't realize it, but what we do be putting in our body affects up here too. And if you're already struggling with up here, why make it worse? So I just think that a lot of these coping mechanisms, like, we just need to find ways to do it on our own and with the help of others, because you won't always have people, but you always have yourself, you know? So it's important to figure out what works for you, how it works for you, what you're gonna do to fix it. I'm not saying that it's an easy way, because it's not. It's never easy. And if medication is working for you and it's making you feel better, then I'm so happy and I'm so glad that that works for you. But if you're someone who's not on medication and you don't want to be, and you need to figure, then you need to figure out what works for you, what coping mechanisms work for you, okay? Whether it be psychology, like talking to a psychologist, like a therapy group, CBT, which is something that I do, and it's really, really helpful, because it's kind of like training your mind to react, or react differently than how you would react with an unhealthy mind or a mentally ill mind, you know? So that's like super important. It's finding what works for you and what helps you. So yeah, that's kind of where I'm at right now, and I'm really proud of myself from where I've come from, because there have been times where I thought I would not have made it to almost 20 years old. Like, that really psychs me out sometimes, because I'm like I really did that. So if you're still watching this video and you're struggling, but you're at a point in your life where you're like, I don't think I can do this anymore, I want to tell you that you can. You can do this, because everybody loves you. I love you. So I don't want to see you or have you feel like there's nothing left to live for, because I promise you, 20 years from now, it's not going to be this bad. It's only right now. Like, all of this is temporary, and that's another thing that we need to remember. All of this is temporary. All this pain, all that, it's not good. I want you to know that I love you. People love you. This is something worth fighting for. You're worth fighting for. And that's basically my story for right now. Yeah, thank you guys for, if you watched this all the way, and thank you for making me feel like I could do this and open up about the things that I've dealt with and all that. It makes me really feel happy that I can do this, because I think, like I said, I think it's so, so important for me to be transparent. Like, I'm on the internet, and there's so many people that can benefit from me talking and saying what I have to say, because some people don't know how to have their own words and say what they need to say. If you need help, I'm always a message away. If you feel distressed, I'm here. You guys know my Instagram, you know my Twitter, you know my Snapchat. You know that you can get in touch with me in like 2.5 seconds, because I'm always on my phone, so I will answer you quick time, girl. Like, there's no reason for you to be alone when I'm here, okay? I'm also going to be leaving some helpline numbers in the description box and across the screen right here. If you need to call someone, call one of these numbers, please. They are ready and to listen to you and help you and make you feel better. They honestly just care about your well-being, and it's completely anonymous most of the time. Like, as long as you don't try to hurt yourself, like, I'm here, they're here. And I hope you guys feel mentally good for the rest of 2019, and you're all safe and happy, because you all deserve it. We deserve it. Thank you for listening to me talk and ramble and be a little emotional on my channel. Yeah, I really appreciate it, and I'm really happy I did this. So, bye guys. Thank you for listening. I love you lots, and I'll see you in my next video. Thank you.